the whole world knows about the 12 Russian spies that were indicted for hacking computers at the Democratic National Committee. I'm going to explain in non-technical terms the 5 techniques that they used so that this doesn't happen to you. That's next. Helpful news analysis on topics that actually matter to you. Get subscribed and hit the bell so you won't miss the next video. Quick affiliate link here. Check out my Amazon page where I have a list of things that I frequently purchase. You'll be supporting Red Blue Talk so I can make more videos like this one. Thank you. This is not an exhaustive tutorial on how to secure your phone or your computer. There's plenty of resources that explain all of that. I'm just going to touch on some of the specific ways that you can avoid being a victim of the kinds of techniques and attacks that were alleged in the indictment. Now, I'm going to read from paragraphs 21A and 21D of the indictment. It's all in there. This is on a section called the manner and means of the conspiracy. It says spear phishing operations. Antonin, Baden, Yermakov, Lukashev, and their co-conspirators targeted victims using a technique known as spear phishing to steal victims' passwords or otherwise gain access to their computers. Beginning in at least March 2016, the conspirators targeted over 300 individuals affiliated with the Clinton campaign, the Democratic Congressional Campaign Committee, the DCCC, and the DNC, which is the Democratic National Committee. For example, on or about March 19th, Lukashev and his co-conspirators created and sent a spear phishing email to the chairman of the Clinton campaign. Lukashev used the account John356GH at an online service that abbreviated lengthy website addresses, which is called a URL shortening service. We'll talk about that. Lukashev used the account to mask a link contained in the spear phishing email, which directed the recipient to a GRU-created website. GRU is the Russian agency that was doing this. Lukashev altered the appearance of the sender email address in order to make it look like the email was a security notification from Google, a technique known as spoofing, instructing the user to change his password by clicking the embedded link. Those instructions were followed. On March 21, 2016, Lukashev, Yermakov, and their co-conspirators stole the contents of the DNC chairman's email account, which is Mr. Podesta, which consisted of over 50,000 emails. Okay, then, and I need to just provide a little bit more background, on or about April 6th, the conspirators created an email account in the name with a one-letter deviation from the actual spelling of a known member of the Clinton campaign. The conspirators then used that account to send spear phishing emails to the work accounts of more than 30 different Clinton campaign employees. In the spear phishing emails, Lukashev and his co-conspirators embedded a link purporting to direct the recipient to a document entitled, quote, Hillary-Clinton-favorable-rating.xlsx. I'm going to stop there, and now let's break down the 5 techniques that are mentioned in those 2 paragraphs. Here we go. Okay, now let's back up and break it down one technique at a time. There's a ton of great software, including some great commercial software, antivirus software, VPN products, and you should definitely use those. But the number one software for preventing a cyber attack is the software that's between your ears. Most of what the Russian hackers were doing depended upon human behavior and a lack of an awareness. So, technique number one is spear phishing. So spear phishing is where specific individuals are targeted using email that is sent by somebody that doesn't reveal their true identity. So in the old days, you might receive an email that said, I'm a prince living in sub-Saharan Africa, and I need you to wire transfer me $5,000 in order to get out of jail. I don't think that works very well anymore because everybody's received that email and it doesn't make sense, and you can very quickly identify that it's just not real. That's old school. Today, the message will look like it's coming from your boss, and it might say something like, here's a link to the latest sales numbers, or something directly related to your job. The hackers are doing this to greatly improve the likelihood that you will respond and take the action that will unlock your door to them. So in the Hillary Clinton case, People were receiving emails within the DCCC and the DNC that looked like it was coming from people that worked there. And that's why those techniques were very effective, unfortunately. Technique number two is called spoofing. Spoofing takes on many different forms. In the indictment, they're referring to making it look like the sender of an email is somebody that you know or trust, like Google, when in fact it is not Google. I know I personally have received emails that looked like they were coming from PayPal, but they weren't actually coming from PayPal. I noticed that in the reply to address, it was some address that did not end in paypal.com, and that's how I was able to detect that. Check the from area of the email very carefully, and if you're still not sure, press the reply button and look at where the message is going. If it's not going back to exactly who you think it should, it's a hack. Cancel it, take a screenshot, and then delete the email message. Technique number three is masking a link. So the simplest form of masking a link is using a URL shortening service to convert a real web address into a short web address that has the exact same destination. Services like bit.ly do this all the time, and it's for perfectly legitimate purposes. The hackers use this technique to hide their own nefarious website behind a shortened URL to avoid detection. A more sophisticated masking hack involves hiding the actual destination from appearing in your browser's location box at the top of the screen. For example, if you click on a link with the words "track your package" and the location box makes you think that you're looking at a delivery service, but you're really at the website of the hackers. You enter your username and your password, and then it's all over. They've got your credentials. So the question is, what's the best way to prevent this? Roll your mouse over the link and look at where it's going in the bottom right corner of your browser. If you don't recognize the domain name, then don't click the link. No matter how authentic the artwork looks, no matter whether the pictures look like they're actually coming from, you know, the company that you think that they are, if they've got the right logo, all that can be made to look very convincing when in fact you are at a hacker's website. So that's masking the link. Technique number four involves malicious documents. So remember how in the indictment that I just read, they said Hillary Clinton favorable rating .xlsx? Well, the recipient probably thought that they were receiving an Excel file with some statistics or some information that they needed in order to do their job. I strongly suspect that the hackers used a link rather than an attachment, because modern email systems are very good at scanning attachments and finding things that shouldn't be there. Regardless, that was no Excel file. If unsuspecting end users were to click on that link, they were connecting to a computer server that was being operated by the Russian intelligence. And how do you prevent that? You ask yourself, do I really know this sender? If I roll over the link, where is the document? Is it at a domain that I recognize, like mycompany.com? Or is it at some weird address that I can't understand that ends in .ru or .co or some other top-level domain instead of .com or .edu, depending on where you work? Got to use your noodle. And the final technique, and this one's all over the indictment, is malware. This is probably one that you've heard a lot about because it has the potential to cause the most damage. Let's say you were fooled. After all, you're a human. The sender's name showed up in your inbox. You kind of recognized it, but it was spelled a little differently than the way your boss spells his name, but you went with it anyway. You didn't bother to check the actual reply to address. You clicked the link to download what you think is a work-related report. Nothing happens. You ignore the whole thing and you move on to the other 300 messages in your inbox, but you just downloaded malware and it installed itself. The magic word for cyber attackers is something called persistence. The concept of persistence means that after they're done with you, they can still get to your computer, even if you reboot the thing. Special instructions were installed in the startup files so that when you reboot your computer, it's still available. That's called persistence, and it means that there's a method of access for the hackers indefinitely. It works because they infect the boot sector of the PC, so prying eyes are always on. The indictment mentions the most common uses of malware. They specifically mention something called keylogging, where every single keystroke that you type in is recorded and tracked by the hacker's computer. That's how they capture passwords. There's something called screen sharing, where they're able to see exactly what's on your screen. If you go to the bank's website, they can see you're at the bank's website. If you type in your username and password, then they've got access to your bank. If you look at paragraph 24C of the indictment, the spies were taking screenshots of DCC employees' computer screens. The second technique is the use of a camera. So most laptops have a camera on them these days, and the hackers can absolutely access that camera. It is absolutely possible. And all of this got started with just one click. The hackers used clever social engineering to mislead unsuspecting users to click on links that would give them access. You know, I once heard somebody say that nobody can drive you crazy unless you give them the keys. Well, I think that what we see in this indictment is that the folks that were working at the Democratic National Committee, the Democratic Congressional Campaign Committee, they gave the hackers the keys. They gave them their passwords. Now, they were tricked into doing it, but nevertheless, the first step in what escalated into some very, very sophisticated hacking was the result of social engineering and giving away passwords. So let me just cap off by saying that nobody that likes you is ever going to ask you for your password on email. This is a very key thing. If you receive an email that says log in here and change your password, that's probably never going to come from your bank or your insurance company or your medical practice provider. Nobody is going to ask you for your password ever. Passwords are very easy for you to electively change. They make it that way on purpose. Don't share your passwords with anybody, not even your mother. Please let me know which of these techniques I spoke about have affected you directly. Spear phishing, spoofing, masked links, malicious documents, malware, or was it something else? The indictment is about an attack from 2016, but these attacks are going on every day of the week. Keep in touch on Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, and I'll see you on the next video.